Yes, so today I'll be talking about GeekCamp. So at GeekCamp cross-browser extensions. So this is all about me. Whatever I do in Mozilla, I volunteer to Mozilla into add-ons community. So it's all about me, like I'm a Mozilla representative. I'm also an add-ons content reviewer, as well as a featured add-ons advisory board member. And I've been a judge at the Firefox Quantum Extension Challenge. And since I talk about add-ons, so I am an add-ons Firefox mentor as well. So let's start about this. Since I have 15 minutes, so I'll be quickly wrapping up. And after that, we can have one-to-one discussion. I'll be out there. So just to make ensure that it finishes in just 15 minutes. So cross-browser add-ons, like browser add-ons are here just to extend and modify the functionality of a browser. It depends on the user, that what a user wants in the browser. That is why we have different add-ons, like Grammarly, just for those who are into content writing or those who are not good with writing even, so they can make the mails or any letter or anything good with the Grammarly by using that, because it helps in fixing and finding out the errors, grammatical errors, spelling mistakes, or punctuation errors. So this is how it suggests you, and you can fix it right away. Next is Ghostery. Ghostery is a privacy add-on which helps you to let you know that which tracker is tracking you on the particular site that you are viewing, and you can actually block them. So this is how and Ghostery gives you the look of being on a website. Next is PrivateX. So this is an extension which actually removes the Google Analytics token by default. So that actually tracks you. So in that way, it also acts as a privacy add-on. And also, it helps the user to open the specific sites like banking sites or any booking.com or traveling sites that stores or that tracks you in a new private window or Cognito window, depending on the type of browser you are using. Next is, this is how it looks like. Next is Facebook container. As we all must be using Facebook, right? But we get the ads on the Facebook what we are viewing the site on. Like suppose we are viewing Amazon and we are viewing something that comes into the Facebook. So if you are using Facebook container, then it will actually create a separate session, and it will be hard for the Facebook to track you, because it creates a completely different session out of the for the Facebook. Next is Tabby Cat. If you are a cat lover here, so you might like love it actually, because it will on every new tab, it will show you different images on the tab. So the basic idea of this is just to make you ensure that add-ons is not about only AI or ML type Grammarly extension. It can be very simple or cute add-ons like this as well. You can create themes as well. So how can we create the add-ons? We can create the add-ons by this cross-browser system, which is web extensions actually. So it helps in developing the add-ons. And how can we develop it? It's simple. You just need to know basic JS, CSS, and HTML just to create your own add-on actually. And with minimal changes, suppose you have already a Chrome extension, then you can easily port it to Firefox or from Firefox to Chrome just with minimal or no changes. And that's it. That's how you can just come up with your own mini project. And that's all required. And you can also get view the resources from different resources from different platforms. Like Chrome has its own developer group, and Mozilla has its own. Like Opera also has its own resources links for building your own add-on. So this is the architecture of the web extensions. In the web extension, you will see the first thing is manifest.json, which is actually the heart of the web extensions, where you actually, this is something like a configuration file. You provide everything inside it, what kind of permissions you give, what kind of scripts, what kind of JS files, icons you need to provide. So this is how a manifest.json looks like in code. So you have manifest version, name, description, icons. You provide almost everything, whatever is required in your add-on. And it has background scripts, so which these scripts are actually loaded when from the time of installation of your add-on to the uninstallation time. You just write the code, whatever is required in the background script, and the JS will be loaded once you install the add-on. And this is how we mention it in the manifest.json. And you can use all the web extensions API, which you can access it through web background scripts. Next is content scripts. Content scripts are similar like normal scripts as well, but they are actually able to access the DOM structure of any website. So, but it has a cons that it cannot actually access all the web extensions API. So for that, we need to interact it through the background scripts. Next is browser action. Browser action actually, whenever you want your add-on to be put in the icon as a in the toolbar, then you use browser action because it should be like suppose your add-on should be applicable to all the sites, then you use this. Otherwise, you'll go with the page action, which is this way. It comes in the address bar, and this is how it differentiate browser action and page action. That way, in that way, that it depends on the add-ons feature. If it's applicable to all the sites, then you use browser action. Otherwise, page action. In case suppose I'm having an add-on related to a specific site, right? In short, then you will go with the page action. Otherwise, Grammarly is used on all the sites. Then I'll use browse action. Next is option page. In the option page, what happens whenever you want to define the preferences, give the preferences to the user so that they can modify after the installation, because every user have their own preferences, choices, and likes and dislikes. So one user might be liking anything, other user, like suppose one user might like the notification, for other user it might be annoying or buggy. So they might change it in the preferences if provided by the developers. So I'll be talking about very less for Web Extensions API. So there's a few Web Extensions API, like Notifications API, Alarm API, Bookmarks API, Tabs, Storage, Web Request. So Notification API, as the name says, it just notifies the alerts the user with a specific thing, whatever you want to give the message, title, or anything you can provide it. And you, for that, you just need to use Notification API. Next is Alarm API. For the Alarm API, whenever you want a particular thing to trigger after a certain period or after any time, you can just use Alarm API. Suppose this example gives you the picture of periodic alarm. So this will actually trigger after every 2 minutes at the first 5 minutes of your installation. Next is Tabs API. Tabs API are used to create the tabs. It's very simple. Whenever you want to deal with the tabs, then you need to use Tabs API. And also like for Windows API, whenever you want to create a new window, then you can use this browser.windows.create with the specific URL. Then in this case, a browser window will be created with these new tabs. So it's very simple. You can see the code. All you need to know about the syntax and how you need to use the Web Extensions API. So next thing is, how can you debug the add-on? Just go to the about:debugging, and then just enable the debugging, and then load your temporary extension, and then just choose the manifest.json, and in that way you can just start debugging your code, because every programmer needs to debug any code. So what are the tools that might be used for developing your add-on? Actually basic, you just need a basic simple editor. It can be Notepad++ or Sublime Text or anything. But for beginners, you can view this site. I'll be sharing the slide after this session as well. So you just go through that, and it can help you. And also for the hardcore developers who are very used to fond of using command line tools, they can use this. And like web extension run, the way debug, I showed you the debugging your add-on thing, the same way web extension run will be used. Actually, if you'll use the working will be similar actually. It's all the difference of the command line tool or the interface UI stuff. Next is, how can you publish your add-on? These are the few links. How can you publish it? And you can read about it later on post this session. These are the few resources. Like as I mentioned, that Chrome has also its own resources, and developer, like Mozilla also has a Mozilla Developer Network. We call it MDN. So it has all the web technology resources like HTML, CSS, JavaScript, as well as VR, or any other kind of new technology which is open source and web technology as well. So if you need any help, like suppose you are stuck somewhere, you don't have any mentor or someone, you can just follow these mailing lists, IRC channels, or add-ons group. If you're on Telegram, just join them and just come up with your queries. Most of the time, your query will be answered in the 24 hours. So it's all done. Hope I wrapped it up in the quite so fast. So any questions, if you have any?
Any questions?
In case you have any questions later on, post this event, you can just use this Twitter handle and tweet, or directly message me. Thank you so much.